Hello, everybody. It seems Erlang getting more popular nowadays, because last time I was speaking there were like 5 people here. Now it's definitely more. It's a good thing. So I'm going to talk how I was using Erlang for developing a web application. I might say modern web application. So this talk consists of two parts. First of all, the overall architecture overview, how to use Erlang in web to build a web application. And the second part is common Erlang gotchas, the common mistakes that you can make while doing development in Erlang coming from other environments. Because Erlang is a very specific language. It differs from other languages and differs substantively. So basically you need to understand how it works to properly do programming in Erlang. As Daniel said, last year I was working on online gaming platform. It's actually, when I came, it was already a huge project. It was like 11,000 lines of source code, which I was able to reduce to 3,500 lines of source code. And I was able to do that by applying OTP primitives. While I was doing that, it was clear to me that the guys who was working on this project before, they definitely came from other environments, programming environments, and they tried to just transfer the knowledge to the new platform. And the results was, mediocre. Right.
Yep.
So I'll tell briefly about Erlang. Why Erlang? So here are usual buzzwords you can hear about Erlang when someone talk about Erlang. So I'm going to talk about it too. So first, Erlang is not only a language; it's also a platform with some nice properties that allows to apply Erlang to build real-time systems. So the properties of the platform is that it could be easily be distributed by the architecture of Erlang applications itself. Also, you need to think about how you handle errors at the first place. So you need to design your application how to handle various kinds of errors. Also, the Erlang platform is portable. It's around practically everywhere. And it's actually very small. So I was doing some Docker packaging with Erlang applications, and the final image was like 25 megabytes for the whole application. So you can have your own fully functional web server written in Erlang package in Docker and taking only 25 megabytes. It's even smaller than common Android application. You know. So also Erlang is a practical functional language. So as I might say that it's the most widely used functional language in production. And the main point is that Erlang is actually quite simple. So there is no actual complicated things in Erlang, and if you understand how it's organized, the things actually goes quite good. Yeah. So what makes Erlang special, how it differs from other things? First of all, Erlang has its own virtual machine, and the Erlang virtual machine is actually one of three virtual machines. So we have Erlang virtual machine, .NET, and GVM. And the Erlang virtual machine was specially designed to ensure preemptive multitasking and soft real-time systems. So they sort of coupled together the Erlang itself and the BM virtual machine. But Also, Erlang as a language has concurrency primitives built in language. So you basically start doing some concurrent programming immediately. So I might say you cannot write an Erlang program, a working Erlang program without being concurrent. Also, it has a built-in NoSQL transactional database called Mnesia. So you have persistence. And also you can utilize some external type annotations to check for type errors, and it actually helps a lot when you start using it from the beginning of the project. If you already have a big project, trying to annotate all the function calls may be tedious and error prone work with many false positives. But if you're doing it from the beginning, it actually helps a lot. Yeah. More about Beam virtual machine. So as I said, it's the primary goal for this virtual machine to ensure preemptive multitasking. That follows that it's actually a soft real-time system. And another main point that when you do programming in Erlang, you actually do it by designing a bunch of interacting processes. And creating processes in Erlang is cheap, and it's actually a language basic abstraction unit. So in other languages, you may have classes, but in Erlang, there are no classes, there are only processes. And sort of classes could be emulated with processes, but it's another topic. Also, each process is isolated. There is no way when one process can access data of another process, except exchanging messages. So all of that are language primitives, they are built in, and and there are properties of virtual machine, and that makes it unique because there is no other things in production that actually ensure preemptive multitasking. So. Why does it fit well for modern web development? Because modern web application gravitates to single-page applications. It's not sites as we used to think. It's more like online applications. These applications are event-driven, client-side. And also, due to the nature of the Erlang, you get the same architecture as server side, started as you go. also, because we can have messages on client on the client side, on the server side, the only thing we need to think how to propagate messages from client to server and from server to the client. And when we have that, we actually have the whole system. Also, it is easy to do WebSockets in Erlang due to the nature of Erlang. And it is easy to have a persistence because we already have Mnesia built in and we can have other database connected. Yeah. Erlang is no silver bullet, of course. It has its own drawbacks. First of all, I might say it's a steep learning curve. So to start doing something useful in Erlang, you actually need to know a lot of things that you don't meet in usual programming. Also, Erlang is known for its weird syntax. Yeah, but it's a matter of taste actually. When you get used to Erlang syntax, it looks actually quite logical and concise. Also, as I said, you need to do some sort of a paradigm change when you start doing things in Erlang. Also, when you are using existing primitives in Erlang, it's a bit verbose. I will show. I have an example. Yeah. Also, another thing is that Erlang is sort of a closed ecosystem. due to the nature of the virtual machine, it's not easy to cooperate with external functions. So you actually may, but it's may cause problem with scheduling, with Erlang scheduler. So as far as I know, it's a known problem, and the guys working on it in Erlang. Maybe the things will be better. And they are still no ETF support in Erlang. It's a shame, but it's true. But so basically, you don't have all these functions built, language support for ETF conversion, but you may use external libraries. Yeah. Also, there are two other languages targeting the same virtual machines, and they are Elixir, heavily influenced by Ruby language and Ruby on Rails framework. And also another thing is Lisp flavored Erlang. It's basically a Lisp that will be compiled down to Erlang virtual machine. I think this is a good thing because Elixir has a simpler syntax. It looks familiar for Ruby developers. So by utilizing Elixir and the Phoenix framework, actually the whole platform will get more people involved. And as far as I know, they're already doing quite good. Yeah, there are also out there some alternatives to Erlang because the whole idea looks attractive for development, scalable and reliable system. Most famous are here, so Go, Scala, Node, so all of them are, could be used as message-oriented platform, but they said none of them has their own virtual machine, so they all share common properties inherited from the properties of the operation system. Also, you may do some sort of Erlang in-house using your favorite language. And here comes modified Greenspan tens rule of the programming. So if you try to implement a complicated distributed system, you will end up with broken Erlang basically. And I'm not sure why should we do that, but people are doing that all the time. For example, take these Docker things. They are actually trying to orchestrate these virtual machines, and the problems they are targeting were very similar to what was solved in Erlang many years ago. Okay. So back to web application. So on client side, we have a single JavaScript process per page. And you do actual client programming by scheduling events in this process. And we can one-to-one match this process with server process. So all client programming actually will be sort of a message broker. That's wrap messages from client and send it to server, receive the reply, parse it, and broadcast to customer. So to utilize that WebSockets, I'm using WebSockets. They have many advantages to the REST. So there is basically no overhead. You don't need to pass all these HTTP headers when you do WebSockets. And when you, the message bus is actually nowadays a usual thing on the client. So when many components exchange messages, so it's a quite standard thing. Yeah, so why to use WebSockets? See, the only difference is that if we are using REST API, we have some sort of standardized endpoints. And when you're doing WebSockets, there are no such, there is no standards there yet, I think. So you need to define your own protocol. It's maybe actually an advantage. Also, by using WebSocket, you can have on the same web page independent components that has their own connection to the server, and the whole load will be small compared to, and the whole processing simplifies because you don't need to multiplex messages client side. You just have one connection and messages passing from server to the exact component it's using. Yeah, on server side, there is a nice, nicely done web server called Cowboy in Erlang. It's a web server done right, I think. It's fully utilized the UTP design principles. So, as you can see, how I handle messages on server side and the client side, they are actually very similar. So when the clients connect to the server spawns a process that handles these connections. So one process, and when the message gets in server, there is another process spawned that handles the message, and then when the results are ready, they are just pushed back to the clients by sending messages inside the server using Erlang concurrent primitives. I'll show you examples. Now I'm going to talk about languages. These basically things that I discovered while I was working on this online gaming project. It has a long history. They're trying to start it starting from 2011. Like three teams changed the process. So it's a kind of compendium of better Erlang code. So I just took a liberty to write some down and explain why it's bad. So the most frequent thing is trying to re-implement UTP primitives by yourself, and it seems to be an easy thing. Because you have all these concurrent primitives built in a language, and it looks actually very simple to do that. But to never do that, you just need to use the UTP. It will save time and development efforts. Also, another thing I discovered that you actually need to know the UTP platform to use it. Because you may just not use it as it meant to be used. The other thing is huge context. So Erlang has been a functional language, it has no assignment. So when you do things in Erlang, it could end that you have one huge context variable, passing it around in function calls. It's actually a sign of a bad abstraction. You actually can achieve the same result by utilizing the UTP platform. Another thing is when you are trying to put everything into one model. The other thing is Erlang specific. So when you actually do programming in Erlang, the best way to do things is to define small functions. Avoiding big nested constructs like many nested cases, ifs, and so forth. Another thing is indirect calls. When you're trying to, to simulate in Erlang some classes, inheritance maybe, by passing on or altering the by not calling function directly but calling them by names. This actually prevents the code being statically analyzed, so you cannot use idealizer after that. And it's very difficult to debug Another thing is when you try to develop your own message queues. As I said, every Erlang process already has a message queue, so you don't need to do it on your own. You can just use the existing Erlang constructions. And these are more architectural goodies. So not using Mnesia is actually a big mistake. It's the pros for Mnesia is that it's built in. It uses the same language as Erlang, and at the same time it's powerful and transactional based. Other thing is not to use dialyzer from the beginning. I already mentioned that. Another thing, when you do project in Erlang and you are not using standard packaging tools like Rebar and Relex. The other things, when you try to re-implement functions that's already existing in the standard library. And the last things, it's more Erlang specific things. There are basically two ways to call a function in Erlang. And the first one, when you just send a message and forget about that. And the second is when you send a message and wait for the result. And to fully utilize the Erlang power, you need to carefully think when you do need reply or when you don't need to reply. So when you can just rely on messages being processed as it's sent, or when you actually need to get a result from the another model. Yeah, and now I'm going to show the examples of the web application I talked earlier. Yeah, this is basically how you do your game server. So all of that need to be present, and this things actually do nothing. It's just an example of a gen server. And if you are doing Erlang and you are not programming gen servers, you are doing something definitely wrong. So basically all your application is a bunch of interacting gen servers. And this is how you define a gen server. It's a bit verbose, and there is no easy way around it. So this is the best I came to. So it's like a template. When I need a join server, I just paste it and modify. Yeah, this is the example of WebSocket protocol between the client and the server. All of that actually are JSON expressions. It's very simple. This is the example client. It's in CoffeeScript. And as you might see, the syntax is very similar to the Erlang syntax, but without the Erlang perks. So you cannot do pattern matching in CoffeeScript. These the things I was actually missing. But as you see, the bullet is the sort of a wrapper around the WebSocket developed by the author of the Cowboy. It has some fallback mechanism, so if the client is not supporting WebSocket, it can fall back for a long polling. So you may just rely on it. And here, basically, is the client. So by calling send, you send a message to the server, and when server is reply, and then event is called with the argument from server, and you just need to route this message to another components of the client. It actually has some error handling built in. And now I show you the server counterpart. this actually all of it. So this is the WebSocket handler. So it works with the client that I showed you before. So here stream is the callback called by web server when the WebSocket message arrives. The info function here allows to send message back to the client by sending a wrong message to this process. And this is actually the processing. So we just parse the JSON, has this array of arguments, and route it through the server. And here is the complete web server based on Cowboy. So it shares files and WebSockets. Here we define how we share our files. And here we define how we handle WebSocket connections. And that's it. So it actually works. Yeah, sure. This one or previous one? Okay. So here we define a module called WS main on the first line. The second line tells us which functions are exported that are accessible from outside. And all of that are actually mandatory callbacks. So record here defines a process state. It's actually defines to nothing. But when the client will be connected to the server, this will be spawned as a separate process handling all the client communication. So you may just authorize your client, put it here in state, and not to pass all these cookies and session IDs anymore, because you already have your connection authorized. Yeah. Here, actually, definition of the functions mentioned on export. Erlang has some peculiarities in its syntax. So its slash number is the number of arguments in a function. It's so sort of a type of a function. And here are definition of the stream function. We utilizing the Erlang pattern matching. So basically it says when we have a message starting with ping, we just need to reply with the same message. So here is the pattern matching, here is the reply, and here is another, the continuation of the definition of the function. So ping is a mandatory WebSocket feature to ensure the connection is alive. So when we get ping, we need to reply. So here it is. And now we expect the message be JSON string. There is no pattern matching in Erlang for JSON. So we need to parse it manually, and here it is. That's it. So it's basically a definition of a function with pattern matching. Do I need to tell about the long pattern matching? So this is actually another feature of Erlang. It's a very powerful feature. It's used everywhere in Erlang. It allows you to define a structure and to match a function call or case or if or many other things with this structure, capturing the matching parts of the structure as a variables. And this is actually what is going on. So we capture very simple structure in variable m, and we can use it in function body. Yeah, here is another thing. So think another example of this pattern matching. So we here we match with array, which first element is binary string msg, and args are some other things we don't know and we don't care. And yeah, that's it. No, there is no multiple matches. So when thing match, then it matches. So, but it allows to match a really complex structure. So you may just use any Erlang term as a pattern matching. I mean, data structure like tuple or array or whatever, even maps. Where?
I lines from the bottom. No. Yeah, end of that line. I don't see where.
This one?
Does it have a handle?
Yeah.
So
yeah, this is actually where the actual processing of message should go. This spawns another process and pass all the parsed variables to this process to handle. It will be it's actually defined here in the handle. Mm-hmm. So in the handle you can just use the same technique by specifying the actual matches for these messages as a function definition and program some results, handling responses and so forth. I didn't put it here, but I have links on the end of the presentation to my project, so you can see the full version. This is the short one. Yeah, actually nothing interesting happens here. It's just some configuration variables needed to run a COBOL server. When you get used to Erlang syntax, it looks actually self-explanatory, but if you're not, it's maybe puzzling. Yeah, but here is the combination of tuples and arrays and nothing more. So I think I can continue.
May I have a question?
Yeah, sure.
What happens when the match doesn't succeed? So here you are basically asserting that this function start HTTP,
yep.
That
it
succeeded.
Yeah, it's actually ensures.
Signified by that, okay, but
yes.
May return something else.
Yes.
The mesh cannot possibly
yes. Yes.
What happens in this case?
In this case, the process just failed. And because it's actually part of a supervision tree, the whole application will fail to run. With some verbose errors, splitting out why it was failed. So this is another common Erlang paradigm when you need to fail early as possible. So basically here we ensure that server is started. When server is not started, whole thing is not started. And so this is the simplest possible error handling case. Here is another example of a REST server based on this COBOL web server. So here are endpoints with some pattern matching. I'm just showing it as example how small and concise the Erlang servers are. And
what? To do pattern matching on strings or?
Yes, this is.
Plain holder there.
Yeah. This is a COBOL feature. He implemented some parsing of strings, and I think it resembles some sort of common things in other, you can find in other web servers. So, yeah, so here, when you specify the, yeah, this will be the variable name. You can retrieve the variable name from parsed request. I will show you, I can show you in the next slide. And three dots actually match to everything goes after that.
Yeah, but it's not native, it's not like...
No. Yeah. So it's just a feature of the Cowboy web server.
Okay.
Yeah. 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 Here the order actually is important because this one matched to everything and it's in the end. So this routes will be looked starting from the beginning to the end for the first match. When the match occurs, the code executes and no other matches will match. But it's not an Erlang feature, it's the feature of this exact implementation of the web server. Right. Yeah, here is the example of the REST handler. It's actually might look a bit cryptic, but it's very simple. So here we again utilize the Cowboy web server to parse requests. The request is actually parsed by the Cowboy. And here are function to retrieve the parsed things from requests. Yeah, and as you saw, there was a variable UUID, and this is how it's retrieved. It actually was abstracted and exists in another model, but it actually looks something like that. You need to call some Cowboy utility to retrieve the data from the request in functional way. This is the actual working example of a Mnesia database, how it looks from programming point of view. Last three slides was about the simple application I wrote. It's a Kiwi store with REST API, obviously, and Mnesia as a backend database storage. So here are examples how to do things in Mnesia. The Mnesia has transactions, so you can transaction is basically just a function. So you define things that you need to do inside the transaction as a function, pass it as a function to the Mnesia, and it does it inside, and as a whole thing. If transaction fails in some part, it will be rolled back, and the data will remain at the previous state. So you basically group all the things that change data all together simultaneously in one function called a transaction. Here also we ensure that transaction is successful by matching it with atomic okay. So it means that the transaction was done successfully. And again, if something goes wrong, we just fail. We don't need to handle errors here, so we just fail. The client will get the error as a reply, so that's it. And here is another interesting thing. Here we write to database, and here we read from database. And we can use Mnesia in two modes. First, as I said, is transactional mode, and the second one is called asynchronous dirty mode, when no transaction is utilized. So when you know that you're just reading data, you don't need a transaction, you may just use this function to execute a function that's supposed to be in transaction, and it will be much quicker as in transaction mode. So when you are sure that reading that data is safe, you may just utilize this. That's it.
And can these key values server work distributed?
Yes.
It's in the nature of the name.
Yes, yes. I already did that. It's actually on GitHub. So you can just run it as a Docker images, connect them together, and you have distributed application. And all of that is done with the same amount of code, just by utilizing existing Erlang features and primitives. Yeah. Right, and here I'm going to explain these gotchas I briefly mentioned before in detail. This is the example of re-implementing OTP. So, guys was trying to define a generic server. Yeah, OTP stands for Open Telecom Platform. Each Erlang distribution contains a huge library called OTP, and library alongside with documentation and design principles. So all you need to do is that read documentation first and try to use it properly. Right? So it's really, really huge library. It contains many, many things. They are well tested and well debugged. So why not? And as I said, in order to utilize it, you need to know it first. And another thing why I say that Erlang has a steep learning curve. Before you start doing things, you actually need to learn a lot of things. And you can't learn a lot of things without doing that. So it's sort of a closed loop. Yeah, but the only way is just to do it, right? But when you start doing that, you can end with something like that, for example. So here, guys, actually using John server, so it's supposed to be a John server. But in this John server, they just spawn another process here, manually, and starting relaying messages from John server to this spawn process. So and manually setting the monitor in this line. So. All of that is a tiny part of actual gen server they was actually using. So, but for the reason now, they decided to re-implement gen server by themselves, and here is how it looks in the end. And trying to re-implement OTP is definitely a bad idea because, as I said, OTP is old, it's well debugged, and when you are trying to do this by yourself, you definitely introduce some subtle bugs that you will need to debug after that. And I don't know. I have no explanation why someone wants to do that, except he was reading a book and trying to do whatever he reads. Yeah. Yeah, there are some packages alongside with this UTP. There is a common test framework.
Can you show us?
No, I didn't include it into the presentation. But it's another huge topic actually, because it's actually very big. The testing framework that we have in Erlang already.
Have you tested the platform? You said that you developed the gaming platform. Did you test it automatically or not?
Yes, we have some tests, right? This is how to actually ignore the UTP. So this model is supposed to be a generic finite state automata. But actually, it is not. It is a Jones error, because for generic FSM in Erlang there is a kind of a special syntax. So you need to define your states explicitly. You need to define transition function explicitly, and then you can call it FSM. And here they decided they don't need to define the states explicitly, so they define them implicitly by providing something like that. There is actually another pattern matching thing. And without explicitly defining transition function, they just use one function called handle sync event. It's actually GenFSM abstraction. But it has its own uses, but you can just replace all of that with a generic server and it will continue to work, see? So there is no reason to define it as a generic FSM without actually using generic FSM. And here it is. Yeah, another thing is huge contexts. It's actually an example from the real code. So here they are passing like 30 variables to one function call. And it's not only the place where it happens. They are actually passing it constantly, you see. And I can see how you get into that. So you just define your pure functions depending only on arguments. Something change, you need to pass something else, and without thinking, you just extend the number of arguments, and say if it goes uncontrolled, it will be something like that. And it's definitely very difficult to work with. All right. The other thing is nested cases and ifs. Here we can see like four levels of nestedness, and so this is definitely a bad thing in Erlang, because in Erlang you need to define your function small and utilize the pattern matching. So it's actually possible to write a project in Erlang even without use of single if. And here we see like two of them already. It's just don't do that. Yeah, this is the example of indirect calls. So actually they were passing some the model names and the function names as functional arguments, somehow parsing them and then just calling them indirectly by name. As I said, it's again very difficult to debug, so you need to know what's exactly inside the variable. And it's impossible to utilize static analysis tools like Dealizer, because when Dealizer tries to analyze the source code statically, it needs to actually see all function calls as it is, and here it's definitely impossible. Yeah, this is a sort of handmade message queues. So when you start doing something like that, you're again doing something wrongly. There is practically no situation when you need to build this message queue manually and pass it for parsing. You just may just send replies as they go. So it shouldn't happen. Yeah, and another thing, it's somehow related with huge contexts. So when you define a context with some variables inside it, and you pass it from function to function, and the state of the context may be altered inside the function. So if you see something like that, it's definitely a sign of that things are going not well. It's actually could be abstracted as a generic server, as I said. because all generic server has their own state, and the maintenance of the state is the work of generic server implementation, right? I think that's all. Yeah, that's all. Questions? Sure. For this key, actually I have a Docker file with instruction how to build the whole Erlang platform from scratch. So if you go to GitHub, you may just grab it and run it as a Docker image and play with that. So it's basically starts from Alpine Linux, a minimal image. It downloads Erlang packages, and then it downloads the repository, compiles it, makes a release of it, deletes everything else, and then you have your image as a 25 megabytes. And that's it.
Regarding this, what is it called? Realizer.
Yeah. No. Yes, yes, it's similar, but because Dealizer is a completely external tool.
Yeah, I know.
So there is no...
If you use it,
yeah.
Consider it as a single, like...
Yeah, but you see, actually, what Dealizer do, it says that something is wrong. It's not ensured that something is actually right, you see? So you cannot be sure that you actually pass something with existing type to the function. Because all functions are typeless in Erlang.
Yeah, but that isn't it able to tell you that, well, not only I didn't find any errors, but I am actually for sure that there are no errors.
No, it's definitely not possible, and it's only partly helpful. So there is no warranty, you see.
Yeah, so it's not that strict.
Yes, so and actually
there are cases which it is not able to see.
Yes.
And
And there is a reason for that, because Erlang was supposed to run some telecom applications, and with this telecom application they do hot code upgrades, and you cannot upgrade your code with typed language, see, because if type was changed, then something will be broken in the middle, and with typeless language you actually do that. It's interesting theoretical question. There is no solution right now, so maybe in the future. But actually, this dialyzer thing was started as an academic project, and later it was integrated in the UTP. So maybe something is going on already.
About the huge context passing, about five before.
Yeah.
Yes,
yes. Only partly. So the dialyzer is useful. It allows you to catch some.
This for the dialyzer is for analyzing every argument and fuses.
Yeah, but not every. See, So it tries its best trying to infer all the types and match with definitions. But when it has no information, for example, if you're using generic server, when you implement behavior that's needed for generic server, you actually lose the types, see? Because no dialyzer can see inside the whole implementation of OTP. It will be too huge.
So, how would you then reduce the context? Would you just read the entire source code?
Yes. This is exactly what I was doing. So, by trying to see what is going on here, where it was defined, how it was used, and so forth. It was a terrible. Yeah, but it's clear sign that something was not abstracted properly. See?
Yeah, sure. It's
yeah.
Is it easy to debug?
Yeah. This is another feature for Erlang that when you can actually connect to the running node with the same shell, with the same repo, and you can run the examples on in the running server. You can even change the code of the running server. So, from debugging point of view, Erlang is very well thought of. So, I mean, you can have the same environment on the in production than you have in the in development. You have the same console, you have the same tools. So
you don't need
the
IDE?
For long? No. You can just go with your text editor.
Have you done some test-driven development with Erlang?
No.
Is it possible? Do you need
Yes, it is possible. You can write tests in Erlang. As I said, there are frameworks for that in Erlang. And for regarding the testing, there is actually a very interesting thing called Quick Check. It's a tool that allows to automatically generate all the test cases depending on property specification. It's it's called property-based testing. When you define the properties of the system that it should have, it should always possess, and this quick check tools generate many test cases and tries to run them all together, and then to filter them to narrow the possible troubles, and. In the presentation, I saw the presentation from the author of this quick check. He said that they was even able to find race conditions using these tools. So I think it's quite interesting also. So as far as I know, I don't know much, but as far as I know, there is no other language with this property when you're able to actually find racing condition before it happens. No, I haven't. It's closed source, it's commercial, and there is open source variants, and I might use it in the near future. So. No, I am not ready to show a number, but it was designed to handle like several thousand simultaneous connections. So, and we actually can do that, can handle this load on regular hardware. So for long, it's not a big load. So. I mean, we are going to measure it soon, like in next weeks, but I just don't have a number right now.
Mnesia, you have some thread pools and routers and so on to be able to process some blocking calls in some bit drivers or things like that.
Yes, they are. So when the Erlang system needs to interact with the outside world, some kind of there are other things in Erlang called ports, and so this way you can have your blocking calls without distracting the Erlang virtual machine scheduling its time between other processes. So yes. Erlang.
It was the same Erlang.
Yes.
So you just use the correct APIs.
Yes, I just took the OTP primitives and just applied when it should be applied. You see, the code reduction was like 3 times. No?
Okay. And how long have you developed this?
I'm working on this like a year.
And what was the biggest issue you faced?
The biggest issue was to run these things the first time, you know. Yeah, it was not easy, and it was failing on some unexpected parts. So you see, it's very difficult to debug things when you have like 30 variables passed to one function and 30 variables passed to another function.
So was it causing real problems in production?
It was not in production. They tried to run it in production. Something was wrong. So, yeah.
Is
Erlang
open source? All the
libraries? Yes. Erlang was open sourced by Ericsson in 1996, if I remember correctly.
Mm-hmm. And you can search for the source code and actually see what's doing?
Yes.
Are you doing it
regularly? No. Because I mean, it might be an interesting reading, but I was trying to do some practical things by utilizing the documentation, and documentation is actually very good in Erlang. So it's documents how you need to think about your system, how to design it using the proper abstractions, and how it's very thorough. It's a bit short. Maybe, but it's very thorough.
You said that you are using Docker for writing programs?
Yes.
Is it compatible with the hot swapping code? Now how can you do hot swapping with the Docker containers?
Yeah, it's interesting question. It's I think with Docker, you just need to replace the container, right? So you're not supposed to do code hot swapping inside the container.
So the way to do it is that you have some distributed system with multiple nodes, and you are just hot swapping Docker image one of the nodes.
So yes, so the Docker image represents one Erlang node. And it could be connected with other Erlang nodes. It could be reconnected, reconfigured dynamically, and so forth.
And are you using Docker in production? Just in development.
In development, yep. But I'm going to use it in production when it comes to. Actually, it's not a big thing, because if I am not using Docker, I will just have regular Erlang nodes, and it actually looks the same, so I can switch anytime, you know.
So with you said that I don't know Erlang, so I'm very specific question. So you said that every piece of code is a process, so and every connection.
Yes.
On the system level also, or no?
It's handled process is run on by Erlang virtual machine, so it's not
so
a system.
Process inside the virtual Erlang.
Yes, it's not a system process, it's Erlang process. And this process can use code from many models, so it's, there is no one-to-one correspondence between model and the process. No. This is the main difference of Erlang platform among between other things. It's not, it is not relying on an operation system. It has its own things, and this is how they can achieve this preemptive multitasking and soft real time properties. See.
Doesn't it make hard Erlang to compile just in time?
Yeah. Why it should?
Because if you are not using the native context switch machinery, then you are using your own.
Yep.
That operates on the virtual machine.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you took some piece of code and jitted it somewhere into memory, then you would lose part of the preemption granularity. Able to switch to another process using the Erlang mechanism.
Mm.
So you would have to create granularity for performance in some way.
I don't know exactly, but when you define your generic server, you actually need to define the way how to do hot swapping. And as far as I know, it's done like that. You have basically two versions of a function, old one and new one. And when old one is executed, it is executed. And when it is replaced, all calls just routes to the new function. So I don't know how it's related with preemptive multitasking. I think
if you have a huge function, you shouldn't have, like, let's say you have, you just inherited some code that is a really huge function.
Mm.
And if there were a just-in-time compiler, it would just look at the function and it would just compile it into a big piece of assembler. Or not assembler, just a code in memory.
Mm-hmm.
But this code then cannot sort of, you cannot switch from the execution of this code easily to another code. Maybe you can do it in some way.
You see,
Erlang is some termination points or something like that. But I imagine that it's not easy.
But Erlang is compiled language. In order to run function, you need to compile it to the beam code. And the beam code is the code actually run by the virtual machine.
Yeah, but
so
it's interpreted by a machine. But it's not further,
it's not
compiled into machine code.
Machine, you mean like hardware?
Like hardware. So
yeah.
This sort of like sounds that there is a certain limitation on the speed.
Yeah, maybe. So I don't dive so deep into guts of Erlang virtual machine, but all I know that they tried really hard to make it responsive.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So basically, if you are after throughput. And you're doing some really complicated processing, and the overall architecture is simple. You're just filtering some data and doing something to it. But it might not be the best thing. But if you have a lot of connections and you are doing many, many, many simple tasks,
Erlang is not good for doing heavy complications. If you have a heavy task, you better offload it to the separate process and just communicate with it. It's an easy thing in Erlang too. So. No more questions. I think this is it.